Sunday morning. Thank you for being in the house of the Lord. Yeah. Some of y'all are maybe still waking up. Some of you have been awake for a long time. Yeah. There's something about Easter Sunday morning kind of gets you all stirred up, right? Get you fired up. So I'm not going to preach long this morning. That's true. Because I got to preach again. And so not for your sake, but for mine, I got to keep a voice, right? So I'm going to do that. Oh, man. John chapter 20 is where we'll be at this morning, on this Easter Sunday morning. John chapter 20. John chapter 20, if you found it, if you would stand out of reverence of God's word, John chapter 20. We'll be doing two verses, 30 and 31. John chapter 20, 30 and 31. And the word of the Lord says this: Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. And I love that. Lord, thank you for what you did for us on a Friday. But Lord, thank you for what you did for us on Sunday. And so, Lord, we thank you that you save. No other name given under heaven by which man must be. Jesus saves. And we thank you, Lord, for that. May this morning, may this service right here, may this be the service where we come together. And, Lord, we are excited. We are thankful. But, Lord Jesus, more than anything, may this really be the service that we as believers come together and we worship our risen Savior. Lord, we love you so much. Would you bless us right now? Lord, I'm going to go ahead and pray for the food. Nobody can leave yet, but I'm going to go ahead and pray for the food in advance. Lord, would you bless this? Lord, all the hands that prepared it, they got here early. They've been working on that. So, Lord, I pray you bless them as well. Give them the strength and the energy they need. Lord, thank you for all that you're doing. We love you so much. We ask these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ, who saves. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. So really the thing that we're going to look at here in verse 30 is where it says, Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. So you've got to see here that really if you were to study up on it, they would say this would have been probably the ending of where John would have stopped at, and that he felt pressed through the Spirit to even write more that we would have in chapter 21. So, you know, that would be a great ending in the sense of what he's saying. And we've got to realize why John did that. And so this morning, I just want to share with you a little bit of John's writing, of how really it's different than the rest of the Gospels that we have. John, man, it is completely different. We look at it and we say, oh, it's the same, or it's got the same stories in it. But really, no, it doesn't. It doesn't. John is completely different than the other four Gospels, and than the other three Gospels. And so the book of John, he only puts a few things in it, really. If you were to go back and start at chapter 1, there's only a few things in it. It's not like the other Gospels. So I went in and put some stuff together for you. There's no detail of Jesus' birth. None. Nothing in John. There's no detail of Jesus' childhood. Not even one mention. None. There's no detail of even the baptism of Jesus in John. None. If you look at chapter 1, it starts with John the Baptist saying, here he comes. Right? But it skips everything else, and Jesus just starts ministry. John is completely different. There is only actually one account that is very short of Jesus' disciples, not even that he called them, but said that they came, only four of them, Peter and Andrew, Nathaniel and Philip. That's it. That's all you got. You got only four disciples in the book of John that is even accounted that it says that he would have called them. Get this, are you ready? There's only seven miracles Jesus did in the whole book of John. Seven. He only wrote seven, but we read it and we think there's 50, right? You read the book of John, you'd be like, man, he's performing miracles all the time. Not according to John, there's only seven mentioned. Now, granted, some of those were extra. People were included in there. But really, only wrote down seven. Seven miracles in the book of John. The first would start with the wedding at Canaan, right? Everybody knows that one. And the last one would be Lazarus come forth. Man, what a powerful one to end on, right? Think about that. Think about John put this together through the power of the Holy Spirit. Last miracle Jesus would do is Lazarus come forth. What's the last thing we're going to have in the book of John? Jesus coming forth. Isn't that awesome? Man, that's pretty good. I thought it was good. Anybody, sorry? We realize that reading in the other gospel accounts that there's more stuff Jesus did, right? They picked up on it. They wrote down some in very, I mean, Luke's in detail, right? Matthew gives genealogy before he ever even starts, right? Doing that. And we'll begin to think about these things. In the book of Mark alone, just the book of Mark alone, the shortest of all the four gospels, only 16 chapters in the whole book of Mark. You can read through it in about 30 minutes if you really sit down and read. 20 miracles are recorded in the book of Mark. John's got seven. The shortest of the gospel has 20. One of the most detailed in the sense of Jesus' love, who he was, seven miracles are recorded. So I wonder, look at this, and John is finishing this up, and he's like, there's a lot of other stuff I could have put in here. Why didn't he? You ever thought about that? Why didn't they write just a little bit more detail? Why didn't they just give us just a little bit something else about Jesus? Well, I'm going to preach a message this morning for the sunrise service. It's just called this, the reason. Right? The reason. Remember, Scripture, there's a reason we've got Scripture. There's a reason it's wrote the way that it is. But it's not coincidence. God knew what he was doing. God knew the people that he had in plan to be able to put this together. He knew the council at Nicaea that he was going to need to be able to bring all this together, right? He knew the people that would be on that council that would make sure that the Bible that we have is going to be the sense of what we need. Nothing took God by surprise. We look at it and we're like, oh, and God's like, I had that plan long before I even spoke the first word. Verse 31. Man, this is fast, man. This is a fast. Probably not the fastest ever I'm preaching, but it's going to be fast. Verse 31. It says this. The reason? But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. You see John's focus? John's focus is this. He says, don't. Yeah, I only put seven miracles in here, but don't miss it. I only put seven things that people would be standing in awe about that Jesus did as far as performing in this sense, in the flesh. Seven, but don't miss who Jesus is. He truly is. The reason I even put those seven in there is so that you would believe that Jesus is the Christ. He came. It was Jesus. It was God in Christ. we could say amen to that, because we're always like, Jesus in the flesh, right? Praise the Lord. We love that. God's here in the flesh. But it was more than just that, more than just the miracles, more than just people's names, more than just genealogy, more than just places that would be put in. I mean, I'm thankful for the other gospels, but John gets to the heart of really who Jesus is. So we realize Jesus does all this. We realize Jesus, but did you realize Jesus is love? Right? We get that. Now watch it. Don't miss it when people say God is love and God loves me the way I am. And God, why did never cut the love of God so short that he can't continually change you. If you think God can only change you twice and he can't help you do nothing else, then you have took the love that he showed and you have squished it together. The love of God never stops. The love of God is what changes us. The love of God, Paul would say, compels me. It's a love. Why? If you say, I can't, then that means you say God's love's not big enough. If you struggle with something and you say, I can't get past it, you're saying the love of God is not big enough. John, you know what he focuses on? Love. John would be known as the disciple whom Jesus loved. What we get that is spread throughout the whole world. You know what it is? John 3:16. What's it deal with? Love. See, you see what God did? God put John in a place that it would be so close to Jesus' heart that he would write about Jesus' heart. He would see it in a way. Now, I just, the other gospels did a great way because that's the way God wanted to use them. But man, he takes John and he pulls him out, and we see the heart of Jesus through the book of John. Unbelievable in the way that he does this. The last part of verse 31 is going to say this. And that by believing, right? That by believing, that means you got to make a choice, right? We've all made a choice. We believe in who Jesus is. And that by believing you may have life in his name. We was with Amanda's family yesterday. Did Easter with them because we wouldn't be able to today. And so we were down there. And one of their oldest boys, I guess, he accepted his call to preach about a year ago. Maybe something. So now he's what, 19? Well, he always asked me, what are you preaching on? They don't know what to call me. Uncle Dwayne, Brother Dwayne, whatever. You know, they don't, they're all confused. Let me go. So, but anyway, so he's asking me. And I told him, he said, now what is that? So I quote scripture to it. And I said, he said, now what's that really talking about? I said, what it's talking about is this. I said, we don't get saved just to get out of hell free car. We get saved so we can really have life in this world without Jesus is not life. It's not worth it going through this life without Jesus. And I said, and John focuses on that. The reason Jesus did everything, the reason Jesus loved the way that he did, is because when you believe on his name through the love that God sent, then you realize, I just received life. It's like I've never had life. And then life everlasting. And so we see this part. By believing you may have life in his name. See, those seven miracles proved that God was in the flesh. Right? Couldn't be done. Had never been done. God in the flesh. The way that he spoke. The way that he did. The things that took place. God in the flesh. But the rest from chapter 12 to 21, get this, John chapter 12 to the end of the book, John chapter 12 to the end of the book is the last week and a half to 2 weeks of Jesus' life. That many chapters. We read it like it's over a span of years. Week and a half. John chapter 12 through 21 talks about his last week. We talked about that Sunday night, Wednesday night, right? Talking about Holy Week, how important that was, everything that took place. John nails it. Nails it down. See, the first 11 chapters, get this, the first 11 chapters of John, 3.5 years worth. First 11 chapters of John, 3.5 years. We read that like it's 8 days. It's 3.5 years. Put into 11 chapters. And it ain't got nothing to do with his birth, his childhood, even calling of most of the disciples. Picks up just at his ministry. 3.5 years. And yet he focuses most of the book of John on a week and a half. Think about that. Wow! Man, that's awesome. I love it. So anyway. So I wonder, do you have life this morning? See, we come to sunrise service not because you're going to get a free breakfast. Go someplace else, get a free breakfast, right? Now, it won't be as good as this breakfast. Now, you can go here, but it'll be different. But the reason we came today, the reason we got up earlier than normal, because we got life. And really, to think about it, hour and 45 minutes early as far as getting to church, died on the cross. Yeah. 3 days, great. Came out victorious. Right now we have victory. 145 minutes ain't much. Once a year. Yeah. See, we think about that. 145 minutes, only once a year. It's not like where I'm sending out a message every week saying, now 8 o'clock, be at church. Just once a year. And you came because you realize what life is. You see, the week that we live doing our jobs, that's not life. This is life. It's the reason John focused most of his book on 8.5, a week and a half in the sense. Realize the importance of being with Jesus. 3.5 years went by just like that in John's book. Yet the last part of Jesus' life, of where he was getting ready to sacrifice everything for us, that week and a half, John spent most of the book in it just to put that in for us so that we could understand the sacrifice that Jesus made so that we could have life. You see, 3.5 years, the first 11 chapters would do no good if we didn't have the rest of it. If Jesus would have said, right, to Pilate, you have no authority except what's given to you. Remember he told him that? I could call right now and they could come. What? If he wanted to, they could have, and it had been over. But where would we be? Think about everything that Jesus was doing based on love. John hits it. He pulls it in. So as Parker and David and Dustin, Sean, come on back up. This morning you say, man, we're about done. I told you, quick. You say, well, this is a different sunrise service. Of course it's a different sunrise service. We're not here for a sunrise service to see people saved. We're here for a sunrise service because we want to worship. He's already done something for us. He came out of that grave, and the reason we came today is because we want to say thank you. We want to say praise the Lord. We want to say that we have victory. We want to be able to say, you know what? Everybody else gets up way early all throughout the week to do the things that they call life. Let's do it today. Hour and 45 minutes early. Let's come in and let's show the world why we got life. Right? So we come in and we get excited about this stuff. People ask me all the time. They say, well, what's the first thing you did when you woke up this morning? Right? In my mind, I probably didn't say it. In my mind, I'm all fired up. I'm fired up anyway. Whenever it's Sunday, right? Sunday, I have the privilege to be able to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, which I'm unworthy to do, yet he allows me to do it. Man, Sundays are awesome. I love it. I love it. Now, I get up. You know what I do? 6:20. Not at it. I'm whistling. Nobody else whistling. I'm whistling. I'm going around waking everybody up. I'm going to whistle. Jesus came out of the grave for us. He came out of the grave for us. He did what nobody else could do. He did it, he said, because I love you. I'm going to do it. We have the scripture, the gospels that are written, and John says the reason that these are even in here is so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Son of God. And when we do that, we come in, we have life in his name, and the world cannot comprehend it, because light came and they still reject it. So we take an hour and 45 minutes early to come and say thank you for giving us life.